Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Oh, wait a minute.
Okay. Well, I got a copy from the president.
Well, County Commissioner Association spokesman I talked to said...
We are now in session, and Mr. Boswell, if you will.
I will.
Have the invitation.
Let's bow our heads, please. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for the rain today to nourish our crops. Dear God, thank you for our farmers who put the crops in and bless them this year. Dear God, be with the soldiers as they go overseas to fight for us and look after them and protect them. And dear God, help our leaders in Washington and Raleigh as they make decisions affecting our economy and the people of this country, and look after them and give them the wisdom they need to make the right decisions. And dear God, be with this board tonight as we go about our business and doing the county's business. This we ask in thy name. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, this time I'll have the public comments, and if Mr. Carter come up here. This is Steve Carter.
Well, I'll start off by admitting that I realize that the issue I want to bring up tonight is not going to be brought up until July. But I saw the article in the paper today about the noise ordinance and 7 a.m. And if you're a hunter like I am, if you aren't shooting by 7 a.m., you're probably not going to get a deer. So I just thought I'd make it clear that you're going to have a lot of upset hunters in the county if a time like that's in play.
Okay. Thank you, Steve. Okay, I don't have anybody else that signed up for public comment, so we will continue on to, we have Mr. Keith Joyce is here. He was on here, but Mr. Shelton Ennis is going to present this, and this is internal controls review report.
If I could, so for Mr. Curl and also,
we can do that now.
If we could do that with, and also Mr. Bass as well.
Okay, I want to,
I'm sorry.
Do you want Mr. Bass to talk before him?
If we
I
could.
I didn't remember.
Yes, well, I'm sorry.
I didn't realize it. Okay.
If you don't mind.
Okay, first of all, let me introduce Mr. Emmett Curl, and if he will stand. Mr. Curl is our new interim tax administrator, and he comes from Raleigh, and if all you read the paper, he has really good credentials, and we were just pleased to, I think we're just glad to have him here, and we're happy that you are here, Mr. Curl. So if you have any questions, call the 570. No, I won't put that on you yet, Mr. Curl.
Thank you.
But if you have anything to say, I'll just let you say it right now.
I would just like to say thank you for the opportunity to assist you in this period of time, and I look forward to the interest and the challenge that takes place, and it should be interesting. And this is I've been doing the same thing now for about 35 years, and even while I was in college I was doing pretty much what I've been doing now, and it's a lot of fun. If you like numbers, and I love numbers, and I like meeting people, and I've met some great people here already, so thank you for the opportunity.
You're so welcome, and I think we're fortunate to have Mr. Curl.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Curl. Okay, and Mr.
Barry Bass.
Barry Bass. Where are you, Mr.
Bass?
Oh, there you are. I couldn't find you, Barry.
I'm kind of a big fella.
I was looking on the wrong side of the room.
You were.
Mr. Bass is going to talk about the
H1N1 virus, yes, ma'am. Very briefly, I just wanted to let you all know that we now have 6 confirmed cases in Alamance County. And how does that compare? Well, there are 11 in Orange County, 7 in Chatham, 6 in Rockingham, and 4 in Person. So if you look around our county, surrounding counties, you can see that we seem to have cases that have all popped up within the last week. In North Carolina, there have been 96 cases with no deaths, which has been a real blessing. You all probably have heard also that the World Health Organization declared a pandemic in the world last week of H1N1 novel virus. And what that means is that it is occurring all over the world. And that means that everybody in the world is a possibility or at risk of catching the disease. So what we're trying to do here in Alamance County is to prepare people and let folks know what the symptoms are, what to look for if you're sick in terms of trying to get to your private provider and doctor. We also feel that there probably were cases occurring in our county prior to actually finding the case, because again, it is widely circulating. I do want to commend the staff at the health department. They've done a most excellent job, and you all be so proud of the professionalism that they've exhibited in terms of doing the case follow-up, for doing the tracking, and for being in touch with our community providers. It's been a community effort whenever this first broke. As a matter of fact, about a month ago, when we thought that there were some suspect cases, and we were doing those case findings. And I really want to thank the folks here in our local government, our folks with emergency management services, the folks with their law enforcement and public safety, looking at our community partners, the Alamance Regional Hospital, the regional physicians, Alamance Burlington School System, and Elon University. We've really worked hard. We've been participating in all the different teleconference calls. We're going to have one again tomorrow to discuss the virus and discuss how we in North Carolina are trying to address it. So I'll be happy to address any questions that you all may have.
Okay. Okay.
You go ahead.
You want me to go first? I'm not sure what day you and I talked last week. Last Thursday.
Yes, sir.
And I get ridiculed at times for asking questions of certain natures. But I just feel like I have to ask questions and get the information that I want to get and use it or not use it. I asked to try to get the ethnic breakdown or class of the one case that I thought we had, and when you and I were on the phone, evidently there were 5 more that you didn't tell me about.
No, we didn't find out until later, yes, sir.
Okay, well, you and I spoke after 4 o'clock that day, so I don't know if you got that information after you and I talked. But, and I'm being told that you cannot give me that information. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And what is your basis for that?
Well, basically in public health, first of all, people in this country have a right to have their health care information protected under HIPAA. So therefore, we do not vet information about particular cases. Now, there are particular communicable diseases where that particular information may be vetted. And over the years, for example, with sexually transmitted diseases, there are certain ones that do show ethnicity, race, age, kinds of backgrounds. H1N1, this is a brand new novel virus, so we're still in the process of developing whatever criteria. So the only data that we have, sir, right now is aggregate numbers. We can give you a number of cases, but we don't have anything that tells specifically at this point about any other kind of breakdown.
Okay, I hear that. I called Raleigh, one of the numbers that I asked for. I held for Atlanta for 30 minutes, and they just kept playing tapes over and over for me, but I got through immediately in Raleigh today, this morning. And the gentleman that took the phone call said he couldn't understand at all why I couldn't get this information. He said, let me put you through to this particular woman who was handling all inquiries about the swine flu or the number code there. And she called me back, and I called her back, and she told me she could see absolutely no reason why I couldn't get this information. And said that, of course, they collected this information, and there was no law, no statute, nothing that would forbid this information from being given out. As a matter of fact, she went on to tell me that the first cases in North Carolina, to skew what everybody else might be thinking, that I'm thinking, but at least she told me, and I'm glad I asked the question because I didn't know it. She told me that the first cases in North Carolina were basically white male soldiers that had been abroad. That's what she told me. And that's basically how it came into North Carolina as far as what records she showed. And then she went on to tell me that that there was not a concern yet in the rest homes or the senior centers because it didn't seem to be prevalent there. And I asked her, I said, well, why is that? Is it because they don't mingle maybe out in society as much as young people and or younger adults? And she said, well, she wasn't sure, but said that her guess was, as far as preliminary studies, that maybe a generation ago that they had become immune as a result of maybe something similar happening back then. But she told me explicitly that there was no law, there was nothing that would forbid me from getting this information, that it was certainly information that was collected, and that she couldn't understand why I couldn't get it. So there seems to be some confusion between the hierarchy in Raleigh and your office, and I'd like to have it cleared up.
I tell you what, I will be happy to vet that question tomorrow in our teleconference.
Thank you.
Yes, sir, I'll be happy to do that. And if I may, to follow up on what Commissioner Sutton has said, that most of the cases are in this particular virus are people under age 60, and the preponderance of the cases are young adults and adolescents, older adolescents.
I have what is your suggestion about anything that we can do to protect ourselves from this, Mr. Babb?
Well, basically, wash your hands. Whenever you sneeze, to use the tissue or sneeze into your arm. Yes, ma'am. I mean, it's just simple hygiene because it's like any other, you know, flu virus that's already out there and all. And the seasonal flu kills roughly 36,000 people every year. And that's the folks that Mr. Sutton's referring to, primarily over age 60. And then we have like 200,000 hospitalizations, and that's, of course, in the United States. But, you know, basically we're going to be providing to you, and I say we, our community, our public information officers from all of our organizations, vetting information out to the public on exactly what you're asking me.
Okay.
And we're really working hard now to be prepared for what's going to probably happen in the fall. And I want to thank Mr. Leonard. He and his folks have been extremely helpful in working with us. And I'll ask that question for you.
If you will. So. Yeah. I wish I could remember her name, but if you call and get
Dr. Megan Davies.
Yes, sir. That's it.
She's our expert in that.
That's it. And she's the one who explicitly said she didn't understand why I couldn't get the information.
Is she a HIPAA expert?
No, she's a physician.
Physician, okay.
I mean, it's not said exclusively.
Exactly. Well, you know, I was in Orange County during HIPAA.
Yes, ma'am.
And I was a security officer there. And I do know that you can't even tell if somebody's in the office. If somebody says, is so-and-so there, you can't even tell them that. So
that's where you're identifying a specific person. Yeah. I heard
I'm not sure about that,
right,
either, Tim.
I heard the rhetoric that if there were 1,000 of a particular ethnic background and you said all 1,000, then you're identifying everybody. And as long as it's just you're not really zeroing in on one person, that the information is public record. And it's information that they seek. So,
Mr. Bass, do we expect this to come back in the fall, maybe in another form?
Well, we don't know the answer to that yet. We're suspecting it may. Well, as you can see, we're already, normally seasonal flu is stopped by this point in the year.
Right.
And so any cases that we're seeing now that are like type A influenza are suspected H1N1. So it may not even go away from the summer and just come back, you know, certainly in the fall. But that's, I think, the other scary part is you're going to have H1N1 circulating the same time you have your seasonal flus, type A and type B.
And do we have any shots for that yet?
We have the seasonal flu, yes, ma'am, and they're still working on a shot for H1N1. The great minds at this point seem to be thinking that they're going to be probably a shot and a booster. So there'll probably be two, but that hasn't been confirmed at this point.
Okay.
But they're working on it.
Yes, ma'am, they are working on it diligently, I can assure you.
Can you at least comment on one more thing? You and I, you alluded to it with me on the phone the other day, and I had some people with me, and I couldn't really talk at length with you, but you've alluded to it tonight, that there are certain communicable diseases where you can release, and you identify those.
Let me clarify that. Normally, like at the end of a year, for example, 2008 data, when that comes out, it will show that. You don't normally do that during the course of the year, but in terms of aggregate data, whenever they're showing the summary of a year, it'll break those kinds of things down.
So the information is disseminated.
At some point, and an issue about this particular disease is we haven't gotten to that point yet about how we're going to disseminate. That'll be the question I ask tomorrow.
Fine.
How they plan to do
that. But you do have the information.
It is available in Raleigh. I mean, they are collecting data on cases in Raleigh, okay. And at some point they will have that information.
Any questions? All right, thank you, yes, Mr. Bass.
Thank you.
Okay, Mr. Ennis, I'm sorry. Come right on up in.
That's quite all right. Good evening, members of the board. My name is Shelton Ennis with Joyce & Company, CPA. I'm here this evening with managing partner of our firm, Keith Joyce, to present our report, which I believe is in your packet, on some procedures we performed when we were here last month, looking at the internal controls and the cash collection procedures in the tax department. And when I say cash collection procedures, cash means anything from checks to actual currency received. And we identified several areas there where controls could be strengthened or where they perhaps were lacking, and also a couple of procedures that could be improved or implemented. As far as internal controls, what that means is, for instance, if you were to have a check come in downstairs through the mail, typically you would want, as soon as that check is received by the cashier, you would want that stamp for deposit only so that it could not be negotiated. Another example is in the case of conducting surprise cash counts of cashier drawers, just to on an unannounced basis, to ensure that they're in balance. And and as far as reasons for strong internal controls, there typically are three main reasons. You safeguard the assets, of the county, and cash being as liquid as it is, that's typically a high risk area that you want to make sure you have good safeguards in place. To prevent errors, everybody makes mistakes, and also to prevent unwarranted suspicion of wrongdoing by employees. Having controls in place just kind of takes it out of everybody's mind that there could be something going on that's not right. There were basically three different ways that we kind of ascertained what the process and controls were in place in the tax department over the cash collections. We conducted what we call a walkthrough. We essentially just select a transaction, a payment of from a taxpayer that comes in, and walk that through, trace it through the whole process from the time that it comes in through the tax department to actual deposit in the bank and recording on the accounts of the county's general ledger. And we also asked staff questions within the tax department and finance staff, and reviewed the policy and procedures, and also observed staff performing the transaction processing and daily balancing procedures. Our review and analysis stemmed in part from new procedures that had been put in place after it was discovered a cash bag went missing in December. And so before the missing bag, we noted that the vault access downstairs was not controlled, in fact, cashier had access, and there was not a log sheet to basically keep track of the comings and goings of who's going into and out of the vault. Also, there was no written policies over the collection process. There are a couple things there that have since been addressed, including a safe that is inside the vault itself. There's log sheets now, and no cashier has access to the vault. And also, there are now an established set of written policies and procedures over cash collections. Just to kind of go through a couple of the findings, from our report. Mailed remittances. We noted that there was not a log sheet that is prepared for payments that are received within the, from or in the mail. Typically, you want to have anytime whoever the receptionist is that's opening the mail, just keep a log sheet, and then and that way they can be tracked and reconciled later in the event there are discrepancies. We noted that the county uses a lockbox process through its depository institution, and that looking at actually April's breakdown of payments received, the method of payments received either by mail or in person or by lockbox, 30% came through the lockbox. It appears that it could be possibly underutilized, and having discussion with staff that a lot of payments received from mortgage companies for tax payments that are escrowed through the mortgage companies are actually coming through regular mail and not through the lockbox. Also, if a customer were to have a balance past due, those notices are sent out and the lockbox address is not on the remittance slip, the lockbox address. We noted that when payments come in and it's not clear either with the documentation that's provided what account it's to be applied to, that there's some investigation that's being conducted by the finance department, and in actuality the best place to kind of conduct that investigation who have access to the records tax records, and it should be done in the tax department itself. So that's more along the lines of an efficiency standpoint finding. As far as balancing procedures, we noted that the contents of the cash drawer are not documented by denomination when the daily balancing is done, when the count is done. It's good that they're counting. There's a total and there's a reconciliation to the system, to the computer system, but a breakdown of actually of the denomination of the currencies should be kept track of, the report should be signed by the cashier and the supervisor. And we also noted that there's at the end of every workday, balancing usually takes place around 2 p.m. in the afternoon, and then there's another count being conducted at the very end of the day when the cashiers leave and put their bags back into the vault, and that's really unnecessary. If there's a count being done and you've got these controls in place over the safeguarded over safeguarding the cash that's put into the vault and into the safe, then the end of day balancing is really unnecessary because you've got the 2 p.m. balancing going on every day. Physical security. We noted that there were three individuals that had custody of the vault, sole custody, where they could gain access to the safe. We would recommend that there be joint custody. The vault actually is combination driven, and there's another combination and or key needed to access the safe. So you could have two different individuals holding, those combinations or keys, and so that it would prevent there being any just one person that has access to the vault, to the safe at all times. Those are the major findings, if you have any questions, I'll be glad to answer them. If I'm available anytime if any questions come up after tonight as well.
Anybody have any questions? I appreciate this information. I thought it was really...
I got one question. I hate Mr. Pearl left because I guess he will be the one implementing these things that we're talking about here. How will we proceed with those recommended things?
I've not given him a copy of the report as of yet, but he will be back on Friday, and that's one of the things we will go over with him as well, is ways and processes to implement recommendations that Joyce has made.
What is your suggestion on, and you may not have one, since we are missing that money, we've never found out who took it. If, you know, we still got the same people working down there, other than one.
Right. Well, as,
or do you have a suggestion?
I really don't. I mean, that seems like a criminal investigative matter that
it is, under
is not my area of expertise.
The Sheriff's Department's got it now. So.
Right. So I'm sorry, I don't know, really have any suggestions there. I mean, certainly due diligence on your part has been performed with the investigation and questioning, you know. And so, you know, I'm not sure if there's any... you know, still suspicion there of any active employees.
Well, we've only had one person to lose, so if that wasn't the one that took it, the one that took it's still there is my consensus on it, and because I don't think we've had anybody to leave that department since then. Do you know anybody? I don't know of anybody that's left other than the one, so I just feel like there's something wrong.
Yes, ma'am.
Exactly when did it happen?
In December sometime.
December this year?
Last year. I'm surprised that...
2008.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm really surprised that when I read this and found these faults, if you will, your recommendations are excellent. As a kid, I worked in the cashier's office, and these things were already instituted. And I'm not going to tell you how long ago this was. We won't discuss it. But I'm surprised that we didn't have it here.
Mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am.
And, very good.
And there have been, like I said, a number since the bag went missing, you know, to the time that we actually conducted our procedures. There have been policies and controls put in place, so including the, you know, the safe. So. Okay.
Thank you so much.
Very good.
Okay. Our next presentation is Jason Martin with the White Furniture Factory project presentation. Is this the one I told you to flip back? Jason was telling me how long this was, and I said, Jason, you better flip fast.
Yeah, White Furniture.
Oh, I'm sorry. Good evening, Commissioners. As you may recall, some of you may recall, the White Furniture Factory project began a few years back. And at that time, Cecil Brown with Neiman Capital came to Alamance County to see about doing a historic landmark designation for that particular site, which we have taken through the Alamance County Historic Properties Commission. And at that time, we kind of had said we would keep the commissioners in the loop as to what has happened. And most recently, the Mebane City Council, which was the governing body on the Certificate of Appropriateness, did grant a Certificate of Appropriateness for the restoration of this project. And Cecil Brown has graciously volunteered to come this evening to give you all a brief presentation as to where this project is going. As this is going to be a pretty major redevelopment of land in Alamance County, mixed-use development that will put some property back on the tax rolls for Alamance County.
Okay. So. Hey, Mr. Brown, how are you?
Just fine. And you, Jason didn't tell me I had to be brief.
Oh, he did.
He said I had 45 minutes.
Oh, no. No, sir, I'm afraid you don't, okay? I have learned how to swing this gavel. No, normally it's a 10-minute period.
Okay, and being as a former public administrator in local government, I understand what it means to be brief. And I often think in terms of that, to extend the meeting of an elected body, let the elected officials extend the meeting, administrators be as brief as possible, because it is a public officials meeting. I will not go through the entire packet, because what we have here is the certificate of appropriateness application information. Information contained in the packet of information has been approved in what we call a part two historic application. That historic application has been approved by the State Office of Historic Preservation. It's also been submitted to and approved by the National Park Service. So what's in the application that went before the Historic Properties Commission here in Alamance County has been approved by the state and also by the National Park Service. In the process of moving through that application and actually doing the work itself will be monitored by the actual development work will be monitored by the historic consultants that put together the Part 2 application and also the state. And in addition to that, it will be monitored by your Historic Properties Commission. And this just indicates there's 11 buildings on the site and information in terms of location. I will go through this slides rather rapidly and kind of point out what's to take place. And the certificate of appropriateness really deals with the exterior part of the building. Okay. So I will concentrate on that portion. And then if there's any additional questions, we'll talk about some of the interior parts as well.
Sure.
The major change on site is the parking lot. This site plan that's being in the process now includes 301 parking spaces for the site. The city of Mebane is concerned that we maintain in parking on site as much as possible, yet at the same time do not want to see a parking lot that's a vast parking lot that's not used. So there's 301 spaces on the site. Is the building? Let's see. The old upholstery building. You see, it's surrounded by the parking spaces, and this building will remain. That will be a residential units. Residential units in that particular building. The total plans call for 152 units of residential space. And then commercial space within that facility. The brick walls of the facility will be repointed. This side just indicates the number of 11 buildings. This is the survey of the site. The slides as we go through, it's a repointing of the brick walls, rebuilding those where necessary. The actual nature of the building will not change. The exterior will not change in terms of its appearance. It will be more or less in terms of sandblasted and clean, but at the same time, repointing the bricks where necessary. And all of these changes that will take place on the exterior of the building, again, is according to the National Park Service requirements. This just gives an exterior site of the facility. And these are all references to the exterior in terms of the bricks and things that would have to take place. And the bricks in this area in terms of how we replace those, though that will have to be replaced, actually new brick going in, we will have to select brick, and then the they will have to be selected according to the guidelines of the National Park Service. The roofing section is one of the things that's going to be troubling in terms of actually completing that facility. The old, spider webs are the systems on top, the dust collecting system, that will be removed entirely. It's a non-historic portion. What they call the still part of the main roof. The elevator shafts, these elevator shafts, they will be removed and, as well. What they call the sawtooth monitoring system. These will be removed. A lot of these are non-historic, and where the non-historic, they will be removed and the roofed over. A number of these are historic, that's in the natural site state, have not been changed out in terms of windows and things of that type. They will remain. And this is part of one of the sawtooth monitoring. And this kind of opens the light up into what will be a residential units in this area. So that will be a natural light coming into that particular portion of the building. The white furniture, I think it's three or four loading docks, and these loading docks are all historic, and believe it or not, there's a fire hydrant under this facility here. I'm not sure exactly how it's used, but there's a fire hydrant under that building. These will be restored, including, this is part of the same fire hydrant, loading dock. This loading dock will be maintained as well. And this is part of, white furniture, the DOT and Southern and the railroad shares almost the same property line, but this dock will remain. And the interesting part, probably the better apartment unit will be located in this area, because this roll-up door will actually be rolled up and closed, and windowed will be put in this area. As a matter of fact, there's a number of the roll-up doors that's historic in nature, even internally, will be positioned so that they can stay in the location, open and welded shut to give it that further give it that historic feel. Matter of fact, the building that we're in now, there's a number of doors that's been open and welded open so they cannot be used, but yet the nature of the building is still there. These are just another example of the loading docks that we will be replaced. We restored them. It's a roll-up door. A number of these doors, majority of these doors are not historic, so they will be replaced. So these doors of this type. If you look at this section, these are all actually roll-up doors. Now these doors will be actually rolled up and open, and will be recessed. It will still allow light in, but at the same time, this will be an area for a commercial space on this level that opens into the parking lot. One thing I did mention on the site plan. If you notice, when you have time to go back to that, the Clay Street goes kind of through the property, but not to the extent that it's easy access. You can wander through the property and drive through the parking lot, and that was designed so you not create an additional cut through, but let at the same time allow for easy access to the property. There's a number of those that in the final site plan, we might have to do a little change in. To make sure that the emergency equipment can actually maneuver through that without any hindrance. The fire department has given preliminary approval to the that portion, but there might be a few other minor changes that we'd have to make. It's another example of the doors that will be raised and allowed open. The windows, these windows will be replaced where they can be restored, where we can restore the windows, where that they have to be replaced. We'll actually replace these windows with the steel sash or aluminum sash to maintain the historic preservation part of this. Where we can have to replace a window, the windows might be a little smaller than the original windows in order to meet the requirement in terms of energy efficient and things of that type. Also, we might look at this, and we think in terms of, for those that's familiar with this site, I think there's 11 trains that go through this site on a daily basis with an average speed of about 55 miles per hour. I'm not sure, but that's what they tell me. I've seen them about 55, the ones that I've seen going through. But when we one of the things that we had to do with the Department of Housing and Urban Development is to get the decibel level down at a certain level, and through the techniques of engineering and so forth, they've determined that we can actually get the decibel reading down to around 45 decibels. That will is what they recommend that we do. And so that part will be taken care of, because when you're standing there now, and this is part because of the windows are broken out, you begin to wonder when the trains go by. And so forth, but that will be taken care of as well. This is just another example of the windows. This section, this you notice the steel beams. This is a non-historic. This area will be taken out completely. Madam Chairman, this includes the interior, exterior portion mm-hmm. of the changes. But as I just flipped through this, I'm the one of those I want to point out to you. This area here will be open. As a matter of fact, this entire area will be taken down. At one time, we was going to open this, but this is coming down because this becomes part of the parking lot. Okay. At one time, the idea was to leave this and open this through, but then we started looking at it in terms of making sure there was sufficient parking. This entire building is coming down. This is a non-historic building.
Okay.
And you notice the metaling here. This is a non-historic, so this building comes down as well. And you notice the open areas, open bays. These bays will remain. And I'd also like to point out that the large columns. These columns will remain. If you've been in a number of the West Village and others, you'll see the columns in some kind of funny locations, but in order to line things up, you might have a column in part of your bedroom and things of that type, but it gives it a unique feel to see that. These columns will not be taken out and replaced with steel. You might have to put some steel in for additional reinforcement, but the columns will remain. This is just interior of the building. Could I stop at this point? This is where you see the monitor and the open light coming in. These will be residential units in this location. And just as a side note, there's a young lady that lives in Mebane that works at the VA. She's put her name on the list, so about 8 months ago, and she's calling and want to know when can she move in. So we already have our first tenant, our first resident. Right. Madam Chairman, I will conclude at that point. Okay. If there's any questions, we are not where we would want to be at this time in terms of construction, but we're closer than we've been in the past. There's a number of things that we're working through now in terms of the master lease. And that master lease requires us to pin down the tax credit investors and also the other part of the agreement. So we're still not on schedule, but we see the light at the end of the tunnel.
And has a question for
yes, sir.
Yeah, I just sort of went blank. You have some, currently you have businesses located there.
There's,
what will happen to those during all this period of time?
Well, during this period of time, once we receive the final level of approval, we'll notify the businesses, and they will be they will leave. We'll give them time to relocate.
Aren't they in the back part, though?
Yes.
They're on that side.
Yes.
On that side of the street. Will this be primarily, you know, it's mixed. I understand that. Low income or
no, it's market rate. It's market rate units.
Market rate.
It's just with a HUD insured mortgage, and I tend to when I say HUD, sometimes that gets mixed in with subsidized housing. But it's market rate insurance, market rate apartments with a HUD mortgage insurance.
What size apartments? Two bedroom, three bedroom.
One, twos, and threes.
How many units are you gonna have?
There'll be 152 units.
Really.
Have you done any of these projects previously, similar to this one?
As a matter of fact, we're completing a project in Waterville, Maine. The contractor is going to shut it down at the end of this month. That facility, if you ever want a Hathaway shirt in your life, then it's Old Hathaway Shirt Factory in May. There's only 63 units in that particular structure. The majority of that is commercial space. Just as I was sharing with the with Steve a few minutes ago when I came in that particular facility, once we started leasing apartments, it started slow. There was a mass mailing, and now it's almost leased up, and yet we just finally just finished up with the construction.
And are you going to have retail and mixed retail in there?
There'll be some commercial space. As a matter of fact, there's a number of individuals that's expressed interest in the commercial space in the White Center, ranging from a restaurant out of Burlington to a small boutique and things of that type. So we have the interest there, and people are staying with us as we go through this.
They did a project years ago in Durham. I think it's Brightleaf, Tobacco Warehouse, if I'm not mistaken. And I'm not sure what the square footage comparisons are, but I didn't know if you were familiar with that project.
Yes, I'm familiar with Brightleaf. Brightleaf is primarily commercial.
Right.
Commercial. Right across the street from Brightleaf is West Village. West Village is primarily residential. In West Village, financing the same financing we're talking about in terms of 221 D4, which is a HUD insured project, a limited amount of commercial space, primarily residential. Tom was a partner in that West Village project.
That's interesting.
And we're also looking at projects in North Carolina, one in Winston-Salem, one in the state of Rhode Island, and two more in Maine.
Are you considering any of these malls that have essentially closed down, and you know their stores and everything have moved out, and they're in their own complexes? But we still have the malls that are still standing, and very few shops or whatever are there. Are these under consideration in your area?
To consider.
To do the same kind of thing with the malls?
Well, the majority of the malls will not give us the historic tax credits. And the historic tax credits is really a part of that makes it make the deal work.
So this is,
Yeah, you know, if it's not as old as I am.
I don't know.
Well, I'll tell you that I've been in that building many times. My dad worked there for 25 years, so I'm really excited about this project that's going into. And Cone Mills could be next in Hollywood. Would that not give you a tax credit?
Yes, it would. And as a matter of fact, Tom, I have to keep him off the road because he rides for all these towns. But if I may just make one comment on the remark that you just made, and then I'll take my seat. But when you mentioned someone, your father, working at that facility, it's one of the things that we do in community meetings. And when you begin to do that, you find that the facility is much larger than its physical self. It becomes part of the community, the fabric of the community that goes back and its historical roots. And we would like to, in the Hathaway Shirt Factory, we'll have a place there that demonstrates that passes on and demonstrate and show the heritage of that community. One comment, and I will take my seat. You know, I kind of fuzzed on a little when I talked about
electric. I don't think we even had a clock on you. Go ahead. Okay.
But I had a conversation in Waterville, Maine, and there was a city council member that started talking about the history of that facility that went back generations back in terms of working there.
Exactly.
And as he spoke, it was almost as if you could hear the yesterday coming to life in his voice, and in terms of what that facility not just only meant to him, but what it means to the community. And if we ever get to a point that we lose sight of what got us to this point, then I think we'll really be losing something important. And this is what we hope to leave as part of a community treasure that's going to be there. And the first time I saw White Furnace was 1959. I was on a trailway bus going back to Trenton, North Carolina from Greensboro.
That wasn't my first time. But thank you, Mr. Brown.
Thank you.
Okay, next is United Way presentation by Mr. Derek Steed and Ms. Cindy Brady.
Thank you.
Your name ain't on here, but I know.
Cindy is here to hand out some of what we'll discuss today. I'll give her a moment.
Thank you, dear.
My name is Derek Steed. I'm a volunteer with the United Way and currently serving as the chairman of the board, and Cindy Brady is here as the president of the United Way. Stephen Covey, I think, once said that accountability breeds responsibility, and in fact, we're here today as our own accountability back to you all. A couple years ago, the United Way approached the county commissioners to go in with a public-private endeavor to bring about a single source of information referral for health and human service needs for the Alamance County citizens. And hearing of the memories of yesteryear, we know that the people, 148 or however many thousand people we have in Alamance County, are the realities of today that in fact we must be there to tend to. And we do so through private funds that are raised locally, that are decided how to be spent locally to address local needs. And one of those local needs was an ability to aggregate all of the health and human service agencies into one referral source to get them, someone in need, one of those citizens of Alamance County, out to those charities or governmental entities that provide that need. And we came here to you to ask for support for that, and you were very generous in doing so. So I've come back to you now that we've completed an entire year of having this implemented, and we're moving into finishing up the fifth month of this year. We want to tell you a little bit about some of the statistics and what we've seen. So if you turn to that first page, you see what it is. 211 is just an easy to remember number that people can turn to, like 411 or 911. It began back in 1999 that the United Way of North Carolina got permission to utilize this, and now it covers about 63% of the population of North Carolina. It allows someone to make that call who is in need of health or human service out there within a community to be identified where they are calling from, what community they live in, and by trained professionals be able to get them to those resources. And our local United Way supports that through maintaining that list of the resources that are available. And they can do it either through their telephone, cell phone, or through the internet. On that third page, you'll see just a picture of what it covers currently in North Carolina with respect to our coverage and future service that will be coming online. Your fourth page talks a little bit about the money, and this is where the accountability. You'll see the startup costs on the left were what we came to you for. And I want to be clear, I'm not here to ask for money today, just a report. And you, along with the City of Burlington and the town of Gibsonville, along with United Way funds, started the $8,100 it took to implement this system. Currently, and since then, the United Way funds 100% of the costs ongoing. So every time someone makes a call, there's a cost that the United Way incurs in addition to a minimum fee that we do for that referral. And I'd like to point out that they don't just utilize this. We still get calls at our United Way office for this type of information. You go to the next page. I took a sampling of about 18 counties that I was able to look and compare United Way and a county, and I went down through the demographics of the populations of those counties and say, well, looking at the call volume for a period, and what I did was is just looking at the most current, January through April of this year, and we just got May's on Friday, so unfortunately I couldn't incorporate that. But to show you a little bit about where we stand as a utilization by percent of our population, we're right about on the bottom five there of what's happening, keeping in mind this is our first year. But the next one I think is most telling and most interesting, the next page. And you'll see Alamance County is about the fifth one from the left. The next page you'll see the percent increase. I do business law and I always look at same store sales to compare the same store to this store. So I say, let's take January, April last year and look at January, April this year. And we doubled in the amount of calls that were coming in. And in fact, our report for May just showed a dramatic increase from April to May of the number of calls that are coming in as well. So we are pleased to say that it is being utilized. I wish it were being utilized more, and I think as time goes on, as 211 becomes more of a familiar number among people, and as we find ways to disseminate the use of 211, we'll see this utilization increase. I want to tell you a little bit, though, about that. As you see that we are low in comparison to these other counties, but we're beginning to see an uptick because we're getting a little more months under our belt. Tell you a little bit about the types of calls. So they provide us statistics on generally statewide what we're looking at for these calls. 42% of the needs that were identified in the calls that came in were for basic subsistence, And so that's rental income, money for food, utilities. And we thought, well, how does that compare with our own needs assessment? Every 4 years, this United Way does a community needs assessment. And this past time, we did it with the health department and with Healthy Alamance to determine what our community is seeing as needs. And compare that to it, 63% of our Alamance County residents had incomes below $50,000, and that was a statistic as of 2007. And to give you a picture, a family of four, two adults, two children, needs about $48,000 for a living wage. So to show a little bit about where people are falling in that category, we have a have an issue with our basic subsistence there. 70% of the people who access housing assistance in Alamance County during this needs assessment were senior citizens. So comparing it to these calls and seeing that 40%, 2% are on that issue, we see that as well as being a very important issue in the needs we've identified in Alamance County. Another item where 9% of those needs identified were related to health care. And we're finding time and time again that being an issue for our citizens through our own needs assessment. 15% of residents who are over age 65 were splitting pills in order to make things go longer. 19% of Alamance County reported that there were some days in last month that they had poor physical or mental health that kept them from their usual activities. So maybe that's the sore back from your weekend warrior activities, or it's really something that does not allow you to conduct your daily life activities. These are things that we need to be aware of so that we have the charities and facilities funded in place. And we did focus groups as part of that needs assessment, and one of the top issues were health insurance and ability to pay your bills. Now, we've gone from 5.9% unemployment up to 12% unemployment, and so we're seeing additional stressors in the lives of those people who are the realities of today. And so it's our goal through public-private partnerships like this, and by being accountable to the people who give to us, to be able to come back and to show that we are having an impact. And there are a lot of great charities who do the same to us, who report back their accountability and responsibility, and have done a tremendous job maintaining. So I wanted to thank you, the Commission, for permitting us the opportunity through your funding back a couple years ago to join with us in Gibsonville and the City of Burlington to make this available to people in Alamance County. And while I hope it is not utilized much because the needs decrease, the reality is we know that the needs are there, and so we hope that they can find this resource a valuable tool. If you have any questions, be happy to answer them.
How much increase have you seen over the last 6 months as far as need basis?
We are seeing an increase, and what's happened is as we've gone out and done some of our campaign for raising funds, what we're also seeing are the people who are traditionally giving are now themselves finding some who would like to be recipients of those needs. I'm really pleased to report that Alamance County and the people of Alamance County have stepped up tremendously through the United Way, through their churches, through their other organizations out there. And in fact, you know, our fundraising, we've seen actually an uptick, and we think it's primarily because people know that need is there. Unfortunately, it's that dichotomy that you have when the funding isn't there, the needs are greater. And we see that with a lot of organizations, whether it be education, school system, or any other place. And we do see that the need increase.
I do want to put in a word for this, because I had a guy that a friend, acquaintance, that needed assistance for his wife to get some drugs, and I said, I don't know what to tell you this weekend. Give him the number, and he got results, and I think it's good to know that it works.
Wonderful to hear. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for your time.
Do you notice any group that utilizes this more than any other group?
You know, they provide the statistics on the needs that are being identified, and so the data we get shows that. Another data because they're not meeting with the people, they will provide us data on whether it's English-speaking or not English-speaking, because they have multilingual people handling these calls. And of that statistic, I saw for North Carolina, it was about 5% were non-English speaking, so it wasn't any dramatic difference than, say, the population if we see it from an ethnicity base, but they don't tell the ethnicity. So I can't answer whether we're seeing more of seniors or otherwise because the data they're looking for, particularly on the needs rather than the identity or the
source. I was looking at age group, you know, whether seniors are middle group or young or whatever.
But what we do see from the charities, and as we saw in our needs assessment, is in particular areas you will see greater stresses in particular groups, such as the 70% of those seeking housing are those who are elderly, so unfortunately.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, next on our agenda is North Carolina Forestry Service Annual Report.
Good evening.
Mr. Kenneth Walters.
My name is Keith Walters. I work with the Forest Service, and I just wanted to put a face with the name. And our assistant, Angela Dobbins, is here with me tonight. And I'm going to be real brief and just hit three or four of the highlights in our report. We are a state agency, but we're partially county-funded, 60-40, the 40% being the county's portion. This year, we had 49 tracts of timberland that were reforested or managed for reproduction in hardwoods, come out to around 1,200 acres that was either put back in trees or managed for hardwoods. That's probably about half of what was cut in Alamance County. We had 76 forest management plans and put 2,646 acres in management. Out of the 1,200 acres of trees, that's probably approximately 750,000 trees that were planted this year. Out of the three cost share programs that we supervise in the county, the Forest Development Program, the Forest Land Enhancement Program, and the Southern Pine Beetle Protection Program, approximately $27,000 was reimbursed to county residents last year that we planted trees or had site preparation or timber release done on their property. With the tax reevaluation this year, to keep up the forestry use and farm use on their farms and forestry, approximately 200 acres of open fields were planted. We also do school programs. We've been participating in the Envirothon every year since they started the program in the early 90s. That's held at Cedar Rock Park, and it started with somewhere around 800 students participating in it, and now they've got so many participating they've had to start area and local competition to narrow the teams down that come to the state. We did approximately 8 programs last year within the schools. Our forest fire protection, we are on call 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, somebody for Alamance County. We have the wildfire investigation for all the wildfires in Alamance County, and one of us has to go to investigate what started the fire. We do write citations and warning tickets depending on what we find. The numbers for 2008 were 7 fires for 31 acres, and since January we've had 4 fires for 9 acres. That's very low numbers.
Not right.
But if you remember last year and year before last, it was so dry we stayed under a burning ban almost all year long. These numbers do not show the number of calls we went on. These numbers only show the fires that escaped and someone had to put forth the suppression effort. The numbers for illegal burns or just to go tell somebody, you know, that it's a burning ban on, they need to put the fire out. We didn't take suppression effort. It may not have been in our jurisdiction. We didn't fill out a fire report, but we still had the call that took care of the fire. The previous years, we've been running somewhere around 40 to 50 fires a year. Logging inspections, we conducted 84 logging inspections and re-inspections for around 1,400 acres. Angela was out on maternity leave 3 months this year, and I had seven dispatches on wildfires down east within the state, so I was gone probably 5 months out of the year. Someone was still looking after Alamance County, but they move us around depending on where the qualified person's needed. So these numbers are low. They picked up, this is only a three-quarter report. It picked up in the last quarter here where we were catching up with what we hadn't done before since we both got here. Our contact numbers on the last page, and you also have the state annual report 2008, and you should have gotten a Smokey Bear pocket calendar and the wall calendar.
Did you work Oree County, South Carolina with that fire?
No, I didn't. We were on standby to go, but with the budget situation at that time, the state didn't want to carry us for the dispatch. The way the memorandum agreement with South Carolina is, when we go down there, our state pays all expenses and then submits a bill to South Carolina. And it didn't get to the point where they needed us to do that.
How easy could that have happened here? Are we broken up more than that vicinity was?
We're broken up a little bit more, but the fuel types here aren't what they had down there. They've got hypocosin, which the ground fire is burning. Uh-huh. Here, it's just mainly going to be a surface fire. It's going to burn the leaves and the brush. It's going to be a quick running fire.
Right.
And once you get it caught and died down, most of the time, that's going to be about it. That one, even though you catch the fire, it's going to sit there and smolder for days or weeks. Just like the fire in Hyde and Terrell County this past summer. The fire started in early June, and it burned till September, October, and they didn't declare it out until February, because the ground was burning 6-8 feet deep.
Right.
And until it got enough water to flood it, it's going to stay burning. And that's what we don't have. But we can still have a running fire that can do the home damage that they've had in South Carolina and California.
They lost about 80 homes down there, I believe, if I'm not mistaken. It was a mess. Where is this Tower Ridge? Where was that at?
Tower Ridge fire was in Surry County.
Okay. Yeah. So you got a picture of Pilot Mountain in the background there, and I was just wondering exactly where it took place.
Mm-hmm. Do you actually fight the fires, too?
Yes, ma'am. It just depends on which job they send me.
You may not, but
you may. I got two trips sitting behind a desk ordering supplies in Terrell County and one trip fighting the fire, so it just depends on what they need when they call.
Are you from Alamance County?
Chatham County.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Any more questions? All right.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. The next on our agenda is the Burlington Alamance County Convention and Visitors Bureau 2008 year end report. And this is Mr. Robert Cox, who is the president. Hey, Mr. Cox, how are you?
Doing good.
Thanks, sir.
Thank you. Well, just as bad.
Thank you for your time this evening. What you have before you is our 2008 year-end report, and I'll go over the visitor's guide here in a few minutes. And I'll just kind of briefly run through the report. If you have any questions, just feel free to stop me. The first few pages of the report is our marketing program for the year 2008. You can see by some of the different groups that we're involved with. For those that aren't aware of what the Convention and Visitors Bureau does, our main purpose is to promote Alamance County and try to bring new visitors here to the area. Several ways we do this is our visitor's guide, which I just passed out. This is our brand new piece, just came out 2 weeks ago. We also have an award-winning website that promotes Alamance County as well. And we also attend different trade shows throughout the year to promote the county to event planners and meeting holders. And you can see in the year-end report, the marketing portion, some of the different trade shows that we attend. We also continue to do print media. Some of our current focuses are on the North Carolina Travel Guide, which is the annual state piece that you see for when you visit visitnc.com. That's the piece that you can order from there. Mm-hmm. Our state magazine and various market-specific media, such as sports markets, some meeting event holders, that kind of thing. Continuing on to page 4 and 5, this gives you an idea of the different visitation numbers at various attractions throughout the county. You can see it's a wide-ranging numbers. Pages 6 through 8 give you an idea of where the various collateral that we send out, including our visitor's guide, our wine trail brochure, and the different pieces that we do, where they go. You can see everything from local North Carolina as far away as Oregon, Utah. We send out materials, and we always try to keep track of every piece that we produce so we can account for that. And you'll see on page 7 the different source codes. That's how we reference when we receive a visitor request. We're always trying to ask them where they heard about us from so we can track that and make sure our advertising is doing what we want it to do. And then page 8, you can see some of the different organizations that we're partnering with to get our visitor information out there. Different chambers and other convention and visitors bureaus. And we also always make sure our information is at the different welcome centers. You'll see that information on page 9. We'll be traveling to 3 of the welcome centers on Wednesday to make sure they have on the list up-to-date information. And then page 10, you can see the different usage based on the welcome centers. And as I mentioned earlier about our award-winning website, in the year 2008 it was awarded a Gold Award by our state association. And you can see here some of the visitation numbers on page 11 and 12 for our website. For 2008 we had just over 357,000 total sessions with 1.78 million page views. And page 12 is basically a hits information. And again, page 13 is a different view of the session graphs. On pages 14 through 18, you'll see a historical review of occupancy tax collection, occupancy rate, RevPAR, which is the revenue per available room, room revenue percentage of change, and occupancy collection by percentage of change. So it's a lot of numbers you can see. And then continuing after page 19 through the end of the piece, you'll see economic state data. And one page I definitely want to bring your attention to is page 22. This is our 2007 economic impact on travel. This is done by the State Office of Tourism and the Department of Commerce. We'll get the 2008 numbers this August. They're always about 8 months behind. But you can see we ranked 25th out of 100 counties for expenditures in the area with $140.8 million with a 7.2 increase over 2006. And this accounts for just under $23 million in payroll, with approximately 1,300 jobs in the tourism-related industries.
Have you been able to track where mainly people are coming from?
From what we can tell, it's hard to track the individual day visitors because there's not really any trackable measures, but the hoteliers were always in that southeastern region, Virginia, South Carolina, Tennessee. Those are our peak travel markets.
Yeah, I read that in here. I could see that most of the people like the wine trail.
Yes, it's just
when I was reading it yesterday, I'm like, well, everybody's coming to the Hall River Wine Trail to find out about that, because I was impressed here that it was 13,000. The next one to it was the visitor's guide that they asked about the Hall River, or it got a brochure on the Hall
River. It's a very popular piece, and they with them just receiving their American Viticulture palliation back in end of March. That's a little feather in our cap here. Yeah, it's one of three in the state. So.
Well, it's very good that we have that here.
Yes.
Have you done anything, or will you plan to do anything about the Hall River Trail?
Yes. In our new visitor's guide, we work closely with Brian and the folks at City of Burlington and City of Graham. On page 15, we have a full map that Brian Baker did with the paddle trail, and it when finishing process of doing a interactive map on our website, so you'll be able to highlight and click over and check out the different points.
Good.
But yes, we work closely with the different Parks and Rec folks trying to get information about the trail out there. Any questions? That concludes my report. And this is also available online on our website. It's a digital version with the page turner technology where you can flip the different pages.
Thank you, Mr. Cox. Okay, next on our agenda is Juvenile Crime Prevention Council annual plan. Mr. Anders.
Good evening, Commissioners.
Good evening.
We'd like to present to you tonight next year's annual plan. Seems like that's what you're getting. There's a lot of annual plans tonight. The Juvenile Crime Prevention Council is the administrative agent in Alamance County for about $340,000 of Department of Delinquency Prevention and Juvenile Crime, DJJDP. And we work with children who are at risk of being involved with the juvenile court system and or are actually involved with the juvenile court system. Last year, our programs provided services to over 1,000 children in Alamance County. I'm here tonight with our needs assessment chair, Dwayne Harden, who is also a juvenile court counselor. And I have to say, he has, over the last 9 years, provided probably the yeoman's share of the work done by the Juvenile Crime Prevention Council. You have the executive summary in front of you. You should have the executive summary, which is about 12 pages. The actual report that goes to the Department of Juvenile Justice and Delinquency Prevention is about 80 pages, and we didn't want to give you that entire report tonight. But we do want to tell you and give you some of those highlights because it's our obligation to do that. Commissioner Sutton sits on that board, and we're appreciative. This is a state-mandated, legislatively mandated committee. Dwayne is going to start this presentation telling you a little bit about what the recommendations are for this next year, and I'll kind of finish up that presentation. Ms. Massey, we need signatures on these documents, which is the certification and also our funding grid that needs to be signed by the board chair. So
not
we hope
coming from the county.
Hope to get that from you tonight. Okay. So
I'll get that after we get through.
Dwayne Harden.
Hey, Mr. Harden, how are you?
Right. Thank you for letting me speak it today. Let's see if I can work this correctly. The Juvenile Crime Prevention Council meets monthly on Tuesdays. Commissioner Sutton's there on a regular basis. And we're divided up in several subcommittees, and one of the subcommittees is the Needs Assessment Committee that I chair. We look at several risk factors and needs of the community. We base those on risk assessments that we do with the juveniles and the families we work with, and needs assessments with those families and juveniles. We look at crime data from our department in the Raleigh office and several other aspects. And based on the risk assessments, we're looking at reducing, of course, juvenile crime in Alamance County, which in the last 2 years, juvenile crime in Alamance County has been a reduction. And that shows in there, 2 years ago was 1,069 complaints. This past year was 830-some complaints. So it's going to be, should be less this year also when we do the statistics. We want to reduce the incidence of gang-related crime and gang involvement in Alamance County. We want to increase school attendance and academic performance. And we want to increase parental involvement and subsequent parental accountability. If we target number three, the increased school attendance and academic performance, then I think we could really target every one of those incidents. Our funding recommendations for this past year is that Alamance County Dispute Settlement Center here across the street provides several services for us. They provide the teen court program. They provide community service and restitution program. Resolve and Family Conflict Resolution Program. They facilitate child and family teams for us and mediation. They had requested $205,000 this year because they do provide the bulk of our services. But based on the recommendations that we did this year from our department is to reduce everybody by 7% because of the state budget. So we're recommending they get $190,650. The Teen Achievers Program, which is run through the Positive Attitudes Youth Center, is an after-school tutoring and skill-building program. They requested $48,580, minus 7%. We're granting them $45,179. The Founding Him Ministry through Christian Adventures is truly gang intervention program that works specifically with gang members. They requested $12,000 and minus the 7%, we're giving them $11,160. The Teen Outreach Program through the Health Department, which sees a vast number of kids through three middle schools, requested $43,105 and we're granting them $40,088. That program, when you look at the statistics after they finish working with those kids, maybe about 1% of those kids will get in further trouble. Street Smart Program, which is a new program last year, we're allowing them to have $9,300 for the first 6 months to run their program. And if they continue to do well, we'll fund them for the next 6 months. Psychological services through our department is getting $4,740. Those are psychological tests that we need for out-of-home placements when kids are in need of out-of-home placements. And then, of course, we have the administrative funds that assist with our logistics coordinator position and supplies and stuff, and they're getting $12,555. Services still needed. We're still in need of a mentoring program in Alamance County, a true mentoring program where juveniles are teamed up with an adult and spends one-on-one time with them. The governor's one-on-one program that the state funds possibly will no longer exist after this budget year. We're still in need of a structured day program for kids who really cannot attend school. Not only they're long-term suspended out of school, but they can't. They're also long-term suspended out of the Sells Gun Alternative School. We're in need of a substance abuse intervention integrated program. We're still in need of additional intervention and prevention gang programs, and more programs focused on the Latino population because it is such a barrier, language issues, and trying to provide those services for those families. I'm going to let Gary Ander take over.
So we hope that we have about $340,000 to allocate this year. Last week in the state budget, they were talking about reducing that by 21%. We've reduced this by 7%, but we don't exactly know where that'll be. Our programs are mandated in Alamance County to have a 30% match, and that match generally comes from in-kind contributions, from local cash matches that are gotten through the various organizations that Dwayne just talked about. But in many counties, that cash match comes directly from the county. We certainly recognize that in this budget year, we're not going to ask you for 30%, but I want you to think about that, because as Dwayne just talked about, there are numerous programs that we need to utilize that we could expand or implement that I think would make a huge dent in our juvenile crime rates. You know, I say this all the time, it's that old Fram oil filter thing, you know, you pay me now or you pay me later, and these kind of programs keep kids out of our training schools, our youth, which are now called youth development centers, at $81,000 a year per child. So, you know, if we can reduce that, it's cheap. I do want to let you know that I've been serving as chair for the Juvenile Crime Prevention Council for the last 2 years. My term is up the end of this month. But I'm pleased to let you know that Steve Van Pelt, who's a school board member, is going to take up that position. He's been on the board for many years. And I think that that's a great thing because of the relationship between the school system, law enforcement system, the Juvenile Crime Prevention Council, the Department of Social Services, and all our community partners. That's really going to enhance that relationship, especially with our student resource officers. So I think that's great. Thank you very much for the time, and I'll answer any questions if you have any.
Let me say, Dwayne was more than kind to give me perfect attendance at the meetings. I am improving, and we do have a meeting tomorrow at 12:15. I've already received my phone call. But I have never seen a more dedicated group of people in my life that really care about the youth of this county. And I can only tell you that if either of my two boys probably gone a little bit further over the line, I'm sure that y'all would have given them proper guidance, and we're lucky to have everybody on board down there, and I mean that sincerely.
Thank you.
Mr. Anders, do you get, like, if a kid is expelled, do they come directly to you at that point, or where do they go?
Well, not necessarily. That's one of the things that we're continuing to look at, that we would like to do expansion. Some students who are expelled from school, there is no place for them to go. And
yeah,
so,
I've heard that. That's why I was asking.
So, you know,
the structured day program would probably.
We actually have a meeting on Wednesday to talk about this structured day program, but it's a pretty expensive idea. There is some additional money coming down from through the Governor's Crime Commission, but directly through JCPC's for gang prevention and intervention activities. $75,000 will be allocated towards Alamance if we actually get a good plan together and are able to bring that money here. But we do need that alternative. There are a couple of things going on in Alamance County. There is a day treatment program that's being done by a private mental health provider right now, and the school system plans to do a day treatment program that will be funded through Medicaid funds. And that will help, but it won't cover all those youth who are expelled from school.
Yeah, I had heard that, actually.
But it's a big need.
Yeah, that's a big need.
A big name.
Okay.
Those that have even been expelled from Sellers Gun.
Right.
Have they been in trouble with the law?
That they've already been in trouble before they get there.
Right. Yeah. Right. So you have that, you know, it's a small proportion, but you know that small proportion of youth take up a great amount of the resources. And so if we can, as Duane said, if we can keep children in school, that's our biggest goal, is to keep people, young people attending school and increasing school performance and reducing expulsions. If we do that, we keep children off the street and we keep children
out of time,
gangs, you know. Thank you.
Thank you.
And if you can sign off on those sometime real soon. We need those probably tomorrow.
Okay, I will before you leave, and before I leave, I will check these out.
Thank you.
I have to read what's put in front of me to sign.
Right,
okay.
Right.
Okay. The next thing on our agenda is the appointments to the Alamance Community College Board of Directors, and we do have one reappointment. Of Mr. Richard Fisher. So at this point, I will accept any, if we want a motion to have Mr. Fisher reappointed at this point.
Now, we're having a reappointment and then,
a new one.
Okay, well, I'd like to definitely recommend Richard.
Okay.
I'll second.
Right. Okay, I have a motion and a second. And everybody in favor say aye.
Aye.
No opposition. Okay. So now we have three candidates. We have Mr. Joe Barber, Mr. CeeLo Fawcett, and Miss Priscilla Juan Holt Starling, and Mr. Derek Steed. And at this time, I will open the floor for nominations.
I'll move to nominate Derek Steed.
Okay.
I'll second that.
I have a motion and a second. Any comments? Okay, we have one. Name, it's Mr. Derek Steed, and at this point, I'll say all in favor say aye.
Aye.
No opposed. Mr. Steed, you will be on that board. Mm-hmm. Okay. That went fast. Okay. Next is County Manager's Report.
excuse me. Thank you, Madam Chairman. As the board is well aware of, at last month's meeting, we asked for approval to begin approaching the LGC with respect to our bond refinancing. Mm-hmm. We have sent them a letter and had a response back from them, and everything is a go. The next step in that process is asking you to approve a resolution which authorized the issuance of refunding bonds for the county in a principal amount not to exceed $20 million. And these are the school bonds that were issued back in 1999.
Okay.
Again, as we discussed, with interest rates now, over the next years, we are projecting to save on payments about $1 million over the next 8 years. Okay. So we just need a motion to approve the resolution.
Okay.
I'll make that motion.
Motion.
Second.
Approve it.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. No opposed.
And now, since the motion is approved, we have to approve the order authorizing the $20 million in refunding bonds as required by the Local Government Bond Act. So you approved the resolution, now you have to approve the order.
Do I hear a motion?
No move.
Second. A motion and a second. Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. No opposed.
Thank you very much for that, and we're working diligently to get that done with our bond council and okay. as well. One of the things I did want to do is have our county attorney mention his interesting day today and where we're at on a couple of issues.
Before we go to that, in regards to the bonds, what our bond rating is what?
I think we're at A.
Double A? Is it double A?
It's A or double A. So.
Well, I would hope so. I mean, what's the top? Right. Triple A?
Triple A.
Okay, now how do we go from, how did we descend in that quarter? I don't remember when we were ever triple A, but I do remember we were dollar on close, high double.
That may be one of the things that we look at this time as well, and that's something that BB&T mentioned to us, that this would be a good opportunity to put ourselves back in front of those bond rating companies to see if we can get the rating increase as well. So
we're anywhere close to A. We've dropped.
We're double A.
Okay.
Right. Yeah.
Okay. Are is there a range of double A?
To my knowledge, we've been where we're at right now for several years. I mean, we haven't dropped, hadn't increased or decreased. We've been where we're at.
When you're double A, is there a double A plus or double A minus or?
I think there is a double A minus plus, and yeah, a plus.
Plus and minus. Okay. But this is a good opportunity to get back in front of them and tell our story and have them show look at our finances and see.
So that affects your interest rate. That affects your interest rate.
Yes, sir.
All right. At this time, I'll recognize Mr. Albright.
Thank you. The assistant county attorney and I, we went to Lincolnton today and argued our motion to change venue in the RMS case, and the court granted our motion. So the case is coming back here, and we're going to proceed.
Thank you.
And I also wanted to mention, with your permission, the case that we had last Friday, the Paradise Club case. I'd like the board's permission to equitably adjust the case against Mr. Elliot Barber. I think he suffers from a mental disability of some type. I don't believe he was involved in the matter, and he is one of the heirs to the property, and I don't think it would be fair to punish him for something that others did. So I'd like to try and fashion a remedy that gets the money to the sheriff and to the school system and protects that individual. So just bring that to your attention.
Do you have any problem with that, Sheriff?
Absolutely not.
I just want to make sure. Okay. Right. Do we need to vote on that? Or?
I'll go ahead and proceed. And I'm meeting with Mr. Barber tomorrow.
Okay.
And we'll see what he has to say.
Okay.
Were you contested in Lincoln?
Pardon?
Were you contested in Lincoln?
Oh, yes, yes. Mr. McCarthy's attorney was there and tried his best. Did not prevail.
It's good.
He didn't answer any questions either, did he?
No,
he
didn't.
Okay. Madam Chair, one other thing. In talking with Pat earlier, it's been customary for the board to cancel one of this July's meeting. We are meeting on July 6th and July 20th. We don't have to, but it's been customary, so I just wanted to bring it to your attention to see if there was one you wanted to look at canceling or not. So we're staff is fine either way.
I think we ought to keep it customary.
Yeah, that's fine.
Is that why we were so loaded today?
Well, I was kind of looking at the 6th since that's the July 4th week. So does anybody have any problem with that?
At that
I guess we have to vote on it.
We do have to vote.
Okay.
So move.
I have a motion. Second. July the 6th. Second. All in favor?
Aye.
All right.
That's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, the next is our consent agenda. Does anybody have anything they want to remove from that? Or
yeah, I would. I just want to hear some discussion on G. Because we didn't get the bill until we got here, didn't have a chance to read it. I'd like to know more about House Bill 1130, please.
Well, I did get the bill today at 3 o'clock off the internet. Because when I got down to that point, I'm like, I don't even have that bill, so I did get it. But I'm not an authority on it, so
yeah,
I can't.
Not either. I had, when I first saw it, I thought, well, my goodness, that's going to help the elderly. And so naturally, I thought, well, I may not support our resolution. But I made some phone calls to the House Principal Clerk's office, and they faxed down a synopsis of the bill as well as the bill itself. Then I called the County Commissioners Association and spoke to council there, and I was advised that it's just not a very sound, it's more politics than it is, of course, isn't everything, but that there was a better way to accomplish what some believe is the intent of this bill versus what would happen. And I was given the example that it's not income driven. I'm not sure about that quite. Is it? Does it have an income variable qualifier?
I have read it, but I don't think it does.
I didn't see one.
It's not in it.
Yeah, and the County Commissioner Association didn't see one either, and I can't support it based on what I've read.
Well, I want to read the first three sentences. It's an act. I want to tell you what it is. It's an act to freeze the appraised value of the permanent residence of certain seniors and to amend the Constitution to permit a limitation on the increase in the appraised value of certain residences. Now, this is an age-driven bill, and the age was 70, and anybody over 70 would never have their property revalued if this bill passes, which means that they could, and they can move, they must be a resident of North Carolina, and they must live in their house for 5 years at least before they can even apply for this bill. But I think that it's too much protection for the rich. And I think that's what actually, I don't know any of these people on here. It was several people that sponsored this, but to me, I mean, I understand it should help some of the elderly as well, but I think it will hurt more people than it'll help, because of anybody that's 40 or 50 or whatever, they're going to have to take up that slack somewhere down the line. And so that was the reason I really got in a huff about it this afternoon, and I called Craig and I said, tell me about this stinking thing, because I pulled it up off the internet after. I said, well, I don't have any backup on this thing, so I did find it. So that's the first, and it's three pages. If you want to pull it up, it's under House Bill 1130, and it's then you have to type in Senior Prop 13 Property Tax Relief. And so it goes on, and but it does not mention, and I was afraid it was going to supersede the 25,000 Homestead Act. I think that
this is an addition to, sure, I think. Yeah.
Have you had a chance to read this?
I looked at 30 sometime last week before I stepped into Paradise Lost. I did read it, and it is a it goes beyond. You know, one thing you need to consider: revaluation of properties every 8 years, so you'd be 78 years old.
Right, time you're 70 to 78.
You have to own the property for 5 years, so you may be in your 80s. And I don't know what the life expectancy
has. This is past crossover, though. Is that?
I can't.
Passed through one today, and I couldn't. I didn't have time to do that.
Well, it would have had to. I guess.
Passed through one
now
yeah.
to
it's
be considered.
Passed through one, and but
one thing.
Anyway, all they're wanting us to do is to sign. Is a resolution that we don't want it.
Of course, in the amendment here, it says that this will be brought to vote at the November 2nd, 2010 election.
Yeah, I saw that.
Across the state, mm-hmm. voting for or against to make an amendment.
Okay. If it's approved.
Be a constitutional change.
It's a constitutional change, yeah. Okay, is that okay, Ann?
Yeah, that's right. Okay.
I did get on my study. Mm-hmm. Okay, so is that okay now? We put it back on?
Yeah.
All righty. At this time, I will entertain a motion to accept the consent agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Now we have commissioners' comments. Do we have any?
Yeah. Steve, what you brought up was very interesting earlier. And where's Jason? Is Jason
okay. Right.
Where did I read? I've been looking all night. I've read some of that, but where was it? Where were we shown those recommendations coming from planning?
In regards to the noise ordinance?
Yeah, noise ordinance, yeah. Was that just sent out separately?
Oh, okay. It hasn't come before the Board of Commissioners.
I've read something on it. I mean, where?
It was in the paper.
It was
in the paper.
It was in the planning board just last week.
Okay. And we were mailed copies of it. It's not in this stuff tonight.
No.
I couldn't find it.
Tim, just to help you out a little bit, at the meeting, what we did, we looked at several issues, such as our four-wheel drive issue, hunters, you know, right. ranges, that type thing. And that is one thing we're going to go back with the planning board to discuss. It's not written out. Jason's working on that, I think.
Right. The planning board meeting was a work session for right now. Nothing has been completely determined on that ordinance yet. So there were several items the planning board brought up, but that was something, there was an article in the newspaper.
Okay, was that where I read?
Found.
Okay.
Yeah,
I knew I had read something. I know where.
It's not coming to us yet. We got to work on it.
The plan was is if we were ready was to have Jason present those changes at our July meeting and then set a public hearing for August. But it depends on the time frame. We may or may not be ready for July.
Yeah, I think at this point, both ordinances will not come before the Board of Commissioners at the same time. Most likely, it'll be. The animal control, the planning board had little problems with, but the noise ordinance, they wanted me to make some serious, to look at some serious issues in it. So I plan on taking it back to the planning board next month.
So we may have animal control?
We may.
Right. Animal control may be presented to you to set the public hearing for August, and then probably August we'll look at the noise ordinance changes, or set the public hearing date for it in August.
Okay. Any more commissioners comment?
Yeah, I need to make a comment.
All right.
You three.
Well, I'm going to say this. I predicted when we changed the planning committee, the way we did, maybe I'm wrong, but that there would be more stringent requests for element like leash laws, hunting scenarios, noise scenarios, and I predicted that we would see some liberal, more control attitudes coming from planning as a result of the way we did the planning committee, and I'm going to stick to my prediction, and I hope we monitor it very closely.
Tim, I'm going to put your mind at ease a little bit because we had
Major
Britt there at our last meeting.
Uh-huh.
The biggest issue is the fact of enforcement. And Major Britt made a point of, a lot of times they go three or four times and they don't have anything to enforce things that needed to be enforced.
Well, I understand what you're saying, but I'll still maintain my position that planning is a lot more bureaucratic than it was months earlier, and I'll still stick to that. But we'll wait and see. Will. We'll wait and see.
Yeah. Okay. I think we've come a long way here in this county, especially recently, of being very open with the public. I'm very strong on honesty and integrity, but it was an article in the paper, I believe it was Sunday, and it was very misleading, and I was very concerned about it. And it was quoting you, Linda, that Commissioner Eddie Boswell and County Manager Craig Honeycutt, da-da-da, were all involved in this meeting, and it wasn't. And I didn't see a retraction come through. It also made it sound like it was a personnel committee, which it was not. We had given Mr. Honeycutt the leeway to do what he did and did a fine job. But I don't want to mislead, and this is my point. I don't want the public to be misled because I was asked about this. I received phone calls about it. I didn't know anything about it at that time. Eddie wasn't involved. And it clearly says he was.
No.
So anytime we have anything, anytime we have anything like this, you don't know what we're talking about. It's close.
I've never met Mr. Curl. I didn't meet him tonight. He left.
So. Yeah, I think anytime that we have this, I know anybody can make a mistake that we notify the paper for retraction or something so that we get the correct information out to the public. And this is, to me, it's very important.
Well, let me explain what happened. Okay. They did interview Mr. Curl and another person, okay? And I asked to go into the interview because this because that person is going to answer to this board. And we couldn't have any more than two without going into a closed session on it. We did not go into a closed session on it. And Eddie was also there. Were you not there with us?
No, ma'am.
Who was there with us?
You were the only.
I was the only board member. Right.
And he kept saying no.
And
he wasn't
it's
there.
It's probably my fault that was because I thought it, my mind.
I was gone.
Anyway, it was Gerald York was chosen downstairs, and what was the other little girl?
Sherry.
And Sherry Hook was there, and Mr. Honeycutt and Amy, and I asked to be in on that. So I would know what was going on without getting it second-handed. So that's exactly what happened, okay? So
we put Eddie on there, and it was...
Yeah.
But again, I say if you see articles like this, if you will make the correction so that we keep getting the correct information out to the public.
I actually, it just went... So anyway. But I did want to be there in order to know who we were interviewing, and it was very... enlightening. Mr. Curl was the best person. Okay. Anything else? All right. Any announcements?
We're not going to be here July 6th.
Mm-hmm. Anything? Okay. We are adjourned.
See you.
Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule.